I'm Uh-huh. Yeah, it's gonna be on YouTube, so
probably slide out.
They have some. You got to say, my head is checking.
I'm going to sign out. Okay.
But that's, I don't know, this, I started to sit down there, I'm like, there's all the wires and stuff, it's kind of a tough thing.
This right here.
Yeah, is it going to be starting here?
Is this right here, right?
Yes, sir.
Oh.
I guess so the camera can see, right?
Wow.
I'm sorry.
And I'll see you soon.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, actually, you know what? Not right now.
Exactly. Yeah.
I'll let you see what the second
one
is. Yeah. Yeah.
Described as bold, hands-on, risk-taking, and decisive. And indeed, these are qualities we would expect in our leadership. However, this person is no stranger to innovation. In fact, he served as the CEO and the chairman of his own startup. This person also has a long-standing commitment to improving quality by diffusing best practices across the entire organization. And in fact, we would not be here today without his direct involvement and support. Now, you may be forgiven for the things that I'm talking about myself. Then on a different day, I might. But I am thrilled to be here to introduce you to one of the leading and most influential leaders in healthcare, the 9th Secretary of Veterans Affairs. Let's give it up for Dr. David Schultz.
I really want to thank you for your engagement and involvement in what you're doing to make VA a better place. So VA has a great tradition of developing innovation. All of you know so many of the things that we rely upon every day and families rely upon came out of the VA system. So you are following the footsteps of great innovators in VA. And one of the things that I don't think people realize, so it's really incumbent upon you to let your colleagues around the country, is that with all the responsibilities now that come with so many people who work in jobs and increase productivity and have their RVUs in and healthcare, and be actually probably one of the best places to be able to time to build with the innovative. And so I think that we have to promote and let people understand it's really a great place to be doing the types of things that all of you are able to do. And so many of your colleagues in other positions that just don't sometimes have the ability to spend the time and energy on innovation like we have the ability to be at. And so with that is a responsibility to take what you're doing and make sure that it gets spread throughout the country and that people know about it, and that's really what today is about. So once again, just thank you for being here. Thank you for continuing the work that you're doing, and this is really important for us to do. Well, some of you may know, particularly those who were here last year. How many were at last year's demo day? Only a few. So for many of you, this is new. People then may not know that the TV show is Shark Tank. and I just love the spirit of the entrepreneurs who present the sharks and the honesty that the sharks have. And for those of you who do or have seen Shark Tank, you know that those entrepreneurs that don't get any bids, that don't get one of the sharks to invest, the most common reason is because the entrepreneurs have developed a company or developed an idea or a product to solve a problem. And you can innovate and really not get traction with your innovation if it's not solving. And so one of the things that I'd really like to see us do in our innovation network and for all of you who are working on things is to make sure that you're solving one of the problems that our veterans are experiencing, one of the problems that we as VA are experiencing. And so the question I get most commonly as secretary, probably one of the questions that you're asking to about VA is almost that we have with all the issues that we all continue to talk about that VA suffers from. Is VA fixable? Can we actually fix this system? So how do we fix it? And my answer is, I firmly believe that we can fix this system. And the way that we can fix this system is through transparency and being open and honest with the problems we have. Because the only way that I know is to acknowledge that you have a problem, talk about the problem so that you can find creative ways or to innovate what those solutions to the problems are. But I did in a very public way when I became secretary. I thought, well, let's make sure that we are transparent about our problems. And I identified 13 areas of big risk for the VA, areas that I believe that if we don't solve these 13 risk areas, that we will not transform this organization. We will not create organization that we can feel proud of that accomplishes our mission. And I decided, look, if you're going to do a strategy, go big. Ask the president whether I could announce those 13 risk areas from the White House briefing room. Never been done before by a cabinet secretary. And I, on live TV, went out and gave our 13 risk areas. Did any of you see that, by the way? Okay, so few of you did. Now, so what I would say to you as innovators, what we need to be doing is we need to be innovating and solving our organization. Now, I can't really remember the 13 areas off the top of my head, but let me just read them to you, and then come around to that. So they were access to care, not surprising, with our wait time issues. Paying our providers in general, how we send people out into the community, the quality of care in VA, disability claims and appeals, information technology problems, capital assets, construction, accountability, staffing, bureaucracy, fraud, waste, and abuse, and veteran suicides. What you've been seeing us do at VA is actually ticking through these 13 risk areas and beginning to address them. So in information technology, notice that we went out and we announced that we're creating a strategy to move towards a commercial off-the-shelf technology solution, the same one that the Department of Defense uses. Under facilities and capital assets, going to be disposing of 1,100 facilities vacant or underutilized. So we're beginning to take our accountability. We passed the new Accountability Protection Act. So you'll see the problem in solutions that we're announcing are beginning to address these 13 risk areas. And I would hope that work that comes out of today will help us with that too. 13 areas are too much for me to remember, and I have to pull out a sheet of paper. I've actually developed 5 strategies before, because I can remember 5, but not 13. And so let me just review those. So as you begin to start thinking about your innovations, you need to do over the next year, the more that you can target innovations to one of these 5 strategies, the more that they're likely to stick, the more that we as sharks here in Washington, D.C. are likely to support your innovation and disseminate it. So the first of those strategies involves choice. Is that the fundamental way that we will fix our system is to give veterans more choice, to make them consumers, that we have to have a product that they want. Choose VA as a way to help them improve their lives. And that means that as tough as it is, we're gonna have to open up our system to be more competitive with the private sector. Choose healthcare. They're going to choose between going to a VA facility or choosing to go into the private sector. That will fundamentally raise our level of performance. That will make us be more responsive. We can give veterans information, care about the service that we provide, the more that we can improve our service, the more that they will want to choose us. Overall strategy that fundamentally will put us on a sustainable course to a viable competitive system for years to come. So anything that we can innovate, veteran in control of their decision making, that allows them choice, is going to be key to one of our strategies. Now, the way which we're doing that legislatively, change the rules of the choice program to eliminate the 40-mile, 30-day requirement, which is an administrative rule, to put the clinicians and the patients, the veterans, making role about when it makes sense to use VA, makes sense to get care in the community. So that's the first strategy. The strategy is to improve the timeliness of our services. And this is our issue of wait times. The VA entered in 2014, starting in Phoenix. We still struggle with access to care and wait times. One of the ways that we innovated on this was we now publish our wait times. So it's openly transparent. See on the websites exactly where our wait times are and what they want to get. We updated that now. We are only in the country. There is no other. And this is the way that VA is innovating in transparency. And we will continue to add. We're adding quality of care information. We're adding satisfaction information. We're adding nursing home quality information. So this is a primary strategy on timeliness of access. Disability claims, 89,000 disability claims that people wait more than 125 days for a decision. In September, we're going to be announcing a new process called the Decision Ready Claim, where a veteran will be able to get a decision within 30 days, not having to wait hundreds of days. And we're working on technology to do instant, you can get an instant decision on a credit card or a credit score on your phone. Towards disability claims, where we'll be able to do instant decisions on that. And so there's lots of innovation we can do around timeliness of our services. In appeals, you have to wait 6 years right now if you were to make an appeal claim today to get a decision. In this case, we actually have to have legislative changes because the law was last written in 1930 and we are seeking updates. It went through the House and it passed. Now that Senate version needs to go back to the House and we expect return with that law change. That will give us new room to innovate around appeals. Priority that we're focused on the VA. So this is a pretty big area. This means modernizing our approach to IT systems. It means modernizing our facilities, modernizing our best practices, our management practices. So we've updated our accountability practices, our hiring and firing practices. We're beginning to update our IT systems. These are decisions, quite frankly, that have been put off for decades. Decision there had been 17 years ago, and congressional hearings, consulting reports said to move towards a system that would allow interoperability with DOD and be a more modern system. We put that off for decades, and as Patrick said, do no longer put off decisions. When it comes to modernization, we need innovation to help bring our system up into the most advanced technology and ways of serving our veterans. The fourth area the priority is to focus our resources differently. VA can't be everything to everybody. And so we're focusing now on things that are critical to veterans. Those are ones that, frankly, aren't done well in the private sector, but are important for serve. So PTSD, traumatic brain injury, spinal cord injury, prosthetics, orthotics, blind rehabilitation. The question is, what do we do? Let's see if somebody comes and tells us. They're telling me I'm okay. Don't worry about me. I guess we should, we probably shouldn't leave. Sorry about this, but I think we should probably exit the room.
Remember what he's coming on.
Come on, dude. I'll be free.
You've got to be kidding me.
Okay, Brandon, we'll come back and break this down.
Thank you. use the elevators.
Yeah. What? We need someone to run the airframe for my property. Anyone that knows where they are?
May I have your attention, please?
Please, a fire emergency has been reported in the building. Please leave the building by the nearest exit. Do not use the elevators.
Now, do you have the reserve line?
May I have your attention, please?
Please, a fire emergency has been reported in the building. Please leave the building by the nearest exit. Do not use the elevators.
May I have your attention, please?
Please, a fire emergency has been reported in the building. Please leave the building by the nearest exit. Do not use the elevators.
May I have your attention, please? May I have your attention, please?
Fire emergency has been reported in the building. Please leave the building by the nearest exit. Do not use the elevators.
May I have your attention, please?
Please, a fire emergency has been reported in the building. Please leave the building by the nearest exit. Elevators.
May I have your attention, please?
Please, a fire emergency has been reported in the building. Please leave the building by the nearest exit. Do not use the elevators.
May I have your attention, please?
Please, a fire emergency has been reported in the building. Please leave the building by the nearest exit. Elevators.
May I have your attention, please?
Please, a fire emergency has been reported in the building. Please leave the building by the nearest exit. Do not use the elevators.
May I have your attention, please?
Please, a fire emergency has been reported in the building. Please leave the building by the nearest exit. Do not use the elevators.
May I have your attention, please?
Please, a fire emergency has been reported in the building. Please leave the building by the nearest exit.
parking garage. This is why normally we do a fire watch, but we did not do one for you.
Yeah. Basically, you used to give your vote.
Well, we won't be live.
So
basically, they sleep as told us to just come back in here. But anyway, they said he's coming back.
I'm the last one.
You want the car, you're all out of 2 months. Yeah, so we're going to record. I'm just going to start on a wide. But yeah, I'm just fired up a wide. Yeah, so I don't know what happened. So yeah, the girls watching it.
I'm gonna go back to my seat.
Okay, the dude is going up. Yes, so we'll be down there. So before we go, so they just meet the evening group back.
So why don't people get in their seats if they have. I was informed that there was not actually a fire. That was Sharif saying I was going on too long. So I'm going to be very short in just finishing up my introductory remarks. I know our whole schedule's thrown off because of the fire alarm. So where I was I was describing these five priorities, the fourth priority, which is our efforts in VA in a different way, and the focus on what we're calling our foundational services, those services that are critical to veterans that aren't really replicated. And we were talking about things that impact people that military, like PTSD, traumatic brain injury, rehabilitation services, but we also are thinking about other types of things that we consider foundational. Our approach towards primary care, which is a much more comprehensive integration of behavioral health issues into primary care, we believe is a model that is not readily available in the private sector, so we consider that foundational. I mentioned prosthetics and orthotics, and a number of other military-related environmental exposures, for example. So we have a whole list of foundational services. We're actually a strategy now where I've said to the leaders in VA that talking about investing in these services to make them world-class, polytrauma would be another example, to make these services really rise, to double down on these services that we call foundational. It's not enough to talk about it. You actually have to invest in them. And that means when you listen to a leader, follow the money, follow where they're spending their money and investing. So I am requiring every one of our facilities from non-foundational services into foundational services. And this year we'll move $3.5 billion from non-foundational services into investing in foundational services. And that's when you can tell that an organization is serious about a strategy. So that's our fourth strategy. And the fifth strategy, clinical priority that makes it into the five, is to reduce veteran suicide. And this is really something that I think is absolutely that 20 veterans a day, almost one an hour, will take their life through suicide. And I will tell you, this is us, and I'm sure a lot of you share this, this is just absolutely heart-wrenching every time it happens. As some of you may or may not know, clinical side, veterans tend to come to a VA, either drive their car or come to the VA and actually suicide on our properties for a number of reasons, not all of which I completely understand, but one of them being family staff to discover them. They know that we will handle it in an appropriate way. But I am notified of more and more of these that happen. And so we just have to do more. We have to do better. We have to innovate. I know several of the innovators in the audience today are working on that area. But the whole point of why I'm describing risks are strategy of being transparent about our problems so we can find solutions. Priority areas, hoping that you can remember five like I do. System, improving timeliness, investing in foundational services, focusing on them, and veteran suicide, is because this is really where we need you to innovate on the way that we solve VA's problems and we make us a sustainable, stronger for our country's veterans, one that I believe is absolutely essential to our national security mission. And so I again want to thank you. I'm excited about energy and ideas that you're contributing, and we'll look forward to being updated on everything you do. So thank you very much.
VA and former Diffusion of Excellence lead.
Wonderful. So we're so excited to be here with all of you today. So we're going to be walking you through the process for the next day. But before we get started, we are so lucky at the VA to work with so many fantastic partners from industry and the private sector. And one of those wonderful partners is helping to support today's event, and that's Verizon. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce one of our fantastic partners, Gary DeVoe, to the stage.
So
So as Andrea mentioned, I'm Gary DeVoe, and I'm the lead client partner that supports the Department of Veterans Affairs nationwide. So our team, along with our partners, Ironbow, Get Well Networks, Plum Laboratories, Samsung Business, and CDWG, are proud sponsors of the VA Innovation Day, and we're thrilled to be here today. So Verizon plays an important role in connecting many providers to veterans, and with helping to power the VA's mobile workforce and Internet of Things. Through our integrated solutions and dynamic ecosystem of partner relationships that include our co-sponsors here today, VA's mission is delivering the best veteran experience. So we encourage you to stop by our tables that are along the side of there today. Innovative solutions. But we also want to hear about your initiatives as well and see if we can help out with those. On a personal note, I'm a son of a Vietnam veteran, higher calling. So I really appreciate everything that all of you do to enhance veterans' experience. Verizon's 175,000 employees, 10,000 which are veterans, and our partners here today. I want to thank you for what you do in support of our nation's veterans. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you so much, Gary. So thank you all so much for coming here today. This is part of a long journey for the VA to modernize, to develop the best possible experience for veterans and their families. And we're so excited that you're all here today. History and context on how we got here. The VA has been on this transformation journey to modernize and deliver the best experience for veterans and their families. I can think of no better example, because I'm a room full of nerds like myself, to describe VA's innovation journey, just like NASA's space race of the 50s, 60s, and 70s. So to recap, but all of you probably know this, with the Mercury mission, with a single manned mission in space for us to get up there and test new waters. Then we went to Gemini. These were double manned missions, spacewalks, and we practiced docking our space vehicles. And then finally, we got to the Apollo missions. Finally landed a man on the moon. So maybe it's a little bit of a stretch, but I figure I'm in good company. I wanted to compare VA's innovation journey. So we first started with the Veterans Health Administration Innovation Program. And they harnessed the power of industry and employees by engaging over 270,000 people. And they had employee innovation competitions, which helped launch 9 innovations that have been deployed at one or more sites. This brought you ReachBet, the after visit summary, e-screening, all projects you're going to hear from today. VA Center for Innovation. So the innovation family continued to grow. And the VA Center for Innovation has been focused on using design thinking and entrepreneurship to really understand veterans' needs, their families' needs, and co-design with them new experiences to deliver the best possible opportunities and experiences for veterans and their families. VA Innovators Network. And the VA Innovators Network was built in response to the need to build more innovation capabilities at the front lines of VA, really build the muscle of VA employees so that we can arm them with the tools and resources. The network has gotten started about 2 years ago. 24,000 veterans, and the program has paid for itself to be good stewards of taxpayer dollars. And last but certainly not least, one of the gaps that we felt is that we needed a better mechanism to spread and scale innovations. And that's when Sharif and team launched the Diffusion of Excellence program to systematically share practices. I'm going to turn it over to Sharif to tell a little bit more about the innovation ecosystem here at VA.
Thanks so much, Andrea. So, lingo and different programs that the VA has around innovation, and it really is a function of how many people throughout the agency want to innovate, have tried to innovate, and we're actually trying to catch up from a central perspective to try to bring it all together and align it to Dr. Shulkin's priorities. But really, this is working because there is a core of innovation in VA employees across the country. And that is why these programs have been successful. So what we've done over the last couple of years, as the Innovators Network started, and Dr. Shulkin, who was the undersecretary, had a priority of spreading innovation and best practices, we've brought it all together in what we like to call an innovation ecosystem. The
VA Center for Innovation is an amazing part of the organization that invests in people with ideas across the country, aided by people in the Innovators Network, which is in this middle rung here on this diagram. The Center for Innovation actually allows employees across the country to bring their ideas into a product, into life, into a best practice, whether it be clinical or administrative. And what that does is it allows us to have a core of innovations and best practices that we can work with and try to spread. This middle rung here, after you have your initial products, your initial ideas that have almost come to fruition, there are multiple programs across the agency that are being connected seamlessly through our programs. The first, as Andrea mentioned, is the Innovators Network. We have people across the country in medical centers to help frontline employees bring their ideas to life. These are people who have had experience doing so, whether in the private sector or themselves within the VA, and they have the right skills thanks to Andrea's programs and the Innovators Network that actually train you how to be an innovator. Not that well known, but you can actually train and learn how to be an innovator, to bring your ideas into life and to use all the resources we have, both internally and externally, to do so. And that's what the Innovators Network is about. The Office of Rural Health has been one of the most progressive offices in the agency in allowing for targeted investments in innovations, especially those that target veterans in rural areas, some of whom don't have as much access to our services, through where they live. But also, they had their own approach to identifying best practices in rural areas, because it turns out that a lot of these facilities, a lot of these employees, a lot of these veterans who are giving people ideas every day about how to make the system better, come from rural areas. Being the best from rural areas and offering the best that we can to those areas, thanks to the great support. We also have the VHA Innovation Program, which does a solicitation every year of all of the ideas in the organization and provides targeted investments, again, to those employees to bring those ideas to life. And so all of those are being connected now. And at the end of that, you have a set of best practices, a set of innovations that we have a responsibility as stewards for veterans in the federal government to try to spread across the system. If something is working, practice that is providing value to veterans in a facility, and it's proven its replicability, it's proven that it can be applied elsewhere, we have a responsibility to spread that out. And that's what the Fusion of Excellence initiative is about. We combine the expertise of the people who brought these ideas to life in facilities, and we combine them with implementing those across the country who are replicating this amazing work, proceeding to system widespread. And so you can see the entire continuum of innovation here and how we're applying that in the day. So this is going to be an amazing day. We have people, frontline employees, people across the system who are ready to present their successes. And so we're going to have multiple panels. We have so many great things to present to you that unfortunately you're going to have to make a choice for these time slots on which ones to go to. But that's just to say that there's a lot to talk about. In this upcoming session at 9:50, there are two rooms that you can go to, the Lohrfink Auditorium, which is this one, formal lounge. There will be great stewards at the end of the hallway here at the top of the stairs who can lead you to this room. It's not in this building, but they'll be able to lead you if you have to go to those at the end of this talk. The first panel is going to talk about improving care with data and informatics, and it's going to be right here. Promoting healthier lifestyles through holistic initiatives. So a great whole health approach to veterans that's very innovative. We have a session at 11 o'clock called Health Tech right here in this auditorium panel to focus on a lot of different innovations in that space. And then panel four is improving disease specific outcomes. So pretty tightly focused, looking at ideas and innovations that have impacted clinical care. You will then have lunch on your own from 12 to 1, and you can frequent any of these bold and nearby eateries. Bulldog Tavern is one of my favorites, actually. But all of the specific information about where to find these places to eat is in your information, in your pamphlets, to guide you there. And then in the afternoon, we also have two great panel sessions from 1 to 2:50. Emotional and cognitive health, focused on these very specific priority areas. Secretary at the VHA. Panel 6, that'll be here. Panel 6 will be e-health and m-health innovations. Again, at Copley, 3 to 4:10. Panel 7 will be about timely processes to improve care. This is, again, about that priority to improve the timeliness of our services. And then finally, panel 8 is about improving the veteran employees. If we don't have happy employees, we do not have happy veterans that are interacting with them. So the connection of these two is really important. We have innovations in both areas that we're really excited to talk to you about.
And one quick thing, check your programs are the most up-to-date information. So I see some questions. So check your programs.
Pass back in here.
So your programs has the full lineup and the most accurate information. So that's what you should take a look at to guide you through the day and decide which panel to go to. So what we're going to probably do with the delay is we're going to start immediately after this, and lunch is probably going to be 45 minutes, not an hour. What we're going to do is have people dispatch to the individual panel sessions, and we'll give an update on that. On the plan, I'm starting most likely a little bit earlier from lunch, but we'll give a formal announcement on that in the upcoming panels, just so that we can see where we're at. Thanks for asking. All right, so two other quick announcements. So at the end of each session, we're gonna have an audience choice. So we have this great software called Poll Everywhere, and you can text in your favorite presentation from that panel session. At the end of the day, at 4 o'clock, we're gonna come back all together and we're gonna do a best of the audience polling. So you're all gonna come back in here and select your top presentation from the audience poll choices from throughout the day. And then we'll have some quick closing remarks. So make sure to share your thoughts and feelings. We really want feedback from veterans and their families and the public. So make sure to use Twitter and any other social media channels to share what you hear throughout the day. Also, we have a guidebook app that you can download. We sent out some information over email, but all the program, all the names of all the presenters that you can message and get to know and network with are in this guidebook app that you can download. So definitely take a look at the program so you can find the link to download this app. And it's really, really informative. At the end of the day, from 4:30 to 6, we're having our innovation showcase. Well, we'll have over 80 poster presenters who will also be live demoing their innovations as well. At this event, they're going to have playing card-sized information that has summaries of their innovations that you can collect as you walk around. So that you can collect all these playing card-sized informations of the projects on the ring, so you can follow up after and meet them and get to know them, and that way you can implement those innovations back at your home facility or in communities across the country. QR codes as well. And just a big round of applause to our amazing partners that made today possible. We're so thankful. So we have Easter Seals, Optum, Samsung, Plumcase, CDW, Iron Bow, and the Get Well Network. So we're so thankful for your support. Now what we're gonna do is dispatch. So our first panel session is going to begin in the next 5 minutes. So if you're gonna stay here in this room, stay put. Panelists, please come down to the front. Presenters, please come over here. And if you're going to Copley, please go to the greeters in the back and they'll take you over there. Thanks, everyone.
Oh, yeah, look, you're okay.
Hi, man.
Okay. All right. Nice to meet you.
I'm going to go to the next one.
Not today. There's not a lot going on for us. But yeah, I mean, we cover
because it's vacation time now.
Right. Exactly. So we do a lot of think tank stuff, a lot of like UFO kind of stuff, a lot of stuff happening in hotel conference areas. Organizations know this if they want C-SPAN coverage, now's the time to hold their event, you know?
I see. So they can get it on the record.
Right, right. And I mean, it's just more likely, a lot more likely that we'll cover an event live during this time of the year. The House and Senate are in, that's what we're on. So since they're out, your more organization knows it's more likely that we'll carry it live. And of course that's what most people want, is live coverage. But we do a lot of think tanks too during this month.
I know.
Yeah.
All right, let me get out.
Well, thank you for watching.
Someone dropped the pen. Can you move on to the seat and grab that? Yeah. I'll bring it in.
Hey, want me to give it?
No, I can carry something else if you want. Want to take the camera?
Yeah, if you want, I'll take the cable. If
no,
you
no,
can.
I got it. I got it all. It's all good.
I wasn't sure. Thank you. If you're around, if you wouldn't mind coming in front, we're going to, we have you guys. We wouldn't want to miss you. Hey, man, 15 minutes of fame. So, no, not 15. Okay, reading glasses handy. So our first presenter today is Janice Schwartz, and her presentation is Automation of Cancer Surveillance. Janice.
Thank you. So in 2011, a veteran presented to our emergency room with an abdominal obstruction. He required an emergent surgical resection and adjuvant chemotherapy before succumbing to his death. We failed that veteran. We failed that veteran because he was diagnosed in 2007 with a potentially curable stage 2 colon cancer. He had received all the appropriate therapy. However, he had no surveillance care. Shows and cancellations, and eventually he fell through the cracks. Wrong way. Surveillance care, the poor outcomes for our veterans and our facilities. The Commission on Cancer requires all accredited facilities to provide survivorship care plans to their patients. Many of the VAs and the oncology program office have them. They're all retrospective health commission accounts of care, doing nothing to improve value. In Albuquerque, we've taken a proactive approach. We begin a diagnosis when the patient is deemed a survivor. Care plans follow evidence-based practice, enabling clinical decision tools, which are both disease and stage-specific. We've monitored on this process manually for the past 2 years. We've been able to decrease our no-show rate of cancer patients from 52% to less than 1%. By activating and engaging them in their care. Both automation of cancer surveillance, highlighting when care is due, less of the outcome, result. Because the central data warehouse updates every 24 hours, we are able to capture all colon cancers and ensure that timely and appropriate consultations are in place. So, provide surveillance to the high-grade dysplasias, condylomas, the AINs, those veterans that are at risk for developing cancer. Surveillance in this population prevents cancer from occurring. The system is working, and many sites are requesting it. However, we have a lack of programming support. If you're a programmer here today, or have the power to leverage programming support, we would love to talk to you about the many layers that this tool has to offer. Colon cancer, but for disease prevention, rural health, chronic disease, and just prevention in general. I love the opportunity to speak with you. Thank you.
So thank you for your project. You mentioned briefly there that you requested some programming supports. Just briefly, what type of support were you looking for?
We need somebody who can write the code from the care plans so that we can develop the same kind of tool for all cancers. Cancer bill, they have health factors inside of them. Perfect. We just don't have the programming support to get them up and running.
Yeah, one more.
So you said you reduced your no-show rate from 50% to less than 1%. How did you do that?
Because we talked to the patients at the beginning of care. Most patients, when they come in, they want to know what they can do, what diet they can eat. I mean, they're like sponges. They want to do anything they can to preserve their life. When you tell them that by keeping their appointments, and when they're supposed to get them done, and getting them done appropriately, then they want to come back. It puts them in control.
You mentioned that your program, lead to improve survivability or decrease deaths. Do you know, have you looked at those data nationally, or at least in your program?
So we've looked at many different things. One thing is that when a patient is diagnosed with cancer, if we can catch that early, $1,000 to treat back later or reoccur later and have a progressive disease, it costs over $120,000. So it's not just saving quality of life, it's also saving money for the veteran or for the VA.
Okay, thanks, Janice. Is Jessica Shanahan presenting data driven or scheduling?
Good morning. I'm Dr. Jessica Shanahan and I'm a practicing anesthesiologist at the VA in Boston. A little bit about data driven operating room scheduling. So this ties in directly with Dr. Shulkin's initiatives for data management, improving how we organize ourselves so that we can increase access to care. And timeliness of care. So the admissions of patients after scheduled surgeries is the major way that we can control influx through the hospital. We are becoming more and more advanced in our post-operative surgical care, and we can often predict about how long a patient is going to be in the hospital. But currently we are scheduling our operating rooms around the convenience of surgeon blocks and not around the anticipated length of stay that the patients will have following surgery. Because of this, we are having peaks in our hospital census midweek, capacity of all of the services of the hospital, not just our nursing staff, but our physical therapy, our pathology, et cetera, to be able to take care of our patients midweek. Weekend discharges are often a problem. As anybody knows who speaks to floor care, there's less personnel available, less ability to discharge to a rehab, which makes it difficult for the patient to progress to their next destination. And delayed discharges, as I'm sure you can all appreciate, cost the system millions of dollars. I propose that we modernize our operating room scheduling to help us complete more cases during the scheduled time of 7 to 5, which is when we have the most personnel available, that we keep our hospital census level throughout the week, and that we optimize our time of discharge. General Hospital, they had this idea, and they engaged some leadership from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology to create a mathematical model to optimize operating room schedule around the hospital census. When they did this, there was quite a lot of bickering about when surgeons would have their particular blocks, and ultimately 21% of surgery operating room schedule blocks were rearranged. I have reason to believe that in the VA, we can change more than 21% of these blocks. But just for example, at Mass General, they reduced the add-on wait time for surgical procedures by 25% and the length of stay associated with post-operative care by 5%. This just to my home institution, which is VA Boston, I'm anticipating that we'll save about 280 inpatient days a year, which will save our system alone between $500,000 to $1 million a year. So now I've been so incredibly blessed because I have been by the VA innovation team, but by the chief of staff office at the VA where I work. I was fortunate enough to procure Sloan students who were able to give us some insight in how to reduce our length of stay. And we've been implementing some of those as well. I have procured an operations management PhD candidate who worked on this very project at Massachusetts General Hospital, and he is willing to engage with us for as long as my grandpony can run for, which isn't much longer. And he thinks that he can give us a reasonable schedule which will accommodate other surgeon commitments within a few months of being hired. And then our success will be measured based on hospital census data and length of stay data. Thank you very much for your attention.
Can you tell me a little bit more where you got the estimates of 5% and some of the quantitative estimates? Did you actually run the model at a hospital? And what exactly does the model include?
So Massachusetts General Hospital, when they worked with MIT, they published a paper. The data comes from the paper that they published about a year ago now. So for the purposes of this 3-minute talk, this is very condensed down and cleaned up. There were other variables here. One of them increased their surgical volume during this period, and the length of stay was actually decreasing as well. But if you clean up the numbers so that we can just have a conversation in 3 minutes, this is where this data comes from. What they were most proud of was sort of their peak of this in Wednesday, evening out throughout the week. And so the major way they accomplished this was they were able to use more of the weekend resources and less stress during the middle of the week, even census, so that the services can appropriately plan.
I'm interested in the scalability. Once you can
do this in Boston, how easily can it be replicated across the other?
So my hope is very easily. My hope is very easily, but the problem is that I need somebody with the expertise to be able to run how that's published. So I have somebody excellent in the wings who can accomplish this in a few months, is what he's telling me for me. The problems will be with implementation, with the surgeon flexibility in to accommodate this model. So some of this is going to have to be, you know, a VA leadership priority, shall we say. And it will also be something that I'm going to have to learn along the way with this particular consultant. But he is giving me an estimate of a few months.
Okay, sorry, we got the stop sign, so thank you. Thank you. I want to thank everyone to take advantage of our lunch program, and we're also having a reception after today, so that's another time to catch up with folks and ask more questions. Our next speaker is Haley Hunter-Zake. She's presenting visit information visualization for the emergency department.
To take a step back and just say that machine learning has really integrated itself into our everyday lives. Anywhere from web search to self-driving cars, machine learning has revolutionized many industries while allowing some to actually exist. It hasn't been so much the case in healthcare, so the question becomes why? There are many reasons, but some important ones are the complexity of healthcare, as both a system and a science, the low tolerance for error within healthcare compared to other industries, and the importance of interpretability. So clinicians have to be able to interpret both the process and output of machine learning algorithms in order to correctly implement them in the clinical decision-making process. And the importance of interpretability, this is often how a crude representation of the development of these algorithms goes something like this. Identify a problem, a relevant data set, apply a machine learning algorithm along with evaluating it, and then tack on visualization at the end. To change this, we need to start with visualization, build robust and versatile visualization tools, and then integrate them into the process of the development of these algorithms. So, but first we need to actually create these visualization tools, and as a proof demonstration of this concept, we developed Vivid, an intuitive dashboard for customizable visualization in the emergency department. So I'll take you a quick tour of this database, or this dashboard. First, users can select any VA Emergency Department or Urgent Care Center throughout the nationwide, select a date range, select anywhere from 15 plus metrics and 7 visualization views, filter by disposition, acuity, age, assigned provider, as well as by time of the day, day of the week, and federal holidays. The visualization, as well as a table output that can be downloaded to local files. So just to give a couple of examples of the broad range of visualizations that Vivid can produce, you can produce anywhere from anything from temporal views of common quality metrics, such as the visits per day by month on the left, all the way to minute-by-minute views of emergency department census, while overlaying additional characteristics such as census by disposition on the right. Already using this in the VA Boston to look at issues including investigating the effects of reducing beds in an urgent care center, assessing the contribution of boarding patients to the overall census, and quantifying surges in patients waiting to be seen around shift changes. It is a foundation in which we can actually, with a foundation visualization tool, we would like to start incorporating prediction tools. These can include anything from predicting cumulative and independent admissions, automatically updating problem lists, and predicting clinical orders, as well as many others. With that, I'd like to thank my collaborators, VA resources, and point out some links for demo source code and blog on Vivid. Thank you very much.
Okay, you guys know the routine.
Here. So are you already seeing changes in your clinical practice due to the visualizations?
Yes, so for example, the one issue that we looked at for reducing the urgent number of beds in urgent care center, this was actually a proposal based on the average census. However, when we actually looked at the census minute by minute throughout sort of several months worth of data, actually found that the census exceeded the sort of proposed reduced level of beds for several hours during those days. It was not adequately reflecting the average. So based on that visualization, they decided actually not to reduce the number of beds.
One of the things that the charts
here are taking notes also and are able to give written feedback to the presenters. This is Philip Brannon, presenting Clinic Access Tool Snapshot.
All right, perfect way to look at access. Definitions, new patient, think consults. Established patients, think recall patients. Unscheduled appointments, so that's unscheduled demand. This is very important. I'm trying to go really quick through this. All right, so all right, why is this a problem? Because since the access crisis, we are playing access whack-a-mole. Starting with the wait list, right? And we beat that mold to death. Consult campaign, right? Everything's focused on consults. Those are new patients only. Choice, every time that mold pops up, it's different location, different mold. Recall, this is a mold that not a lot of VAs are focused on. So this is established patients trying to get back into their clinical specialty. To illustrate this, this is an unnamed Division 6 Medical Center. According to the Congressional Report for primary care for this facility, it's 6.41 days to get into primary care. Time, 31 days, according to the access to va.gov website that Dr. Shulkin referenced earlier. Wait time is 7 days, which is pretty good. Wait list. Patients are greater than 90 days. But here's the other problem here. Established patients are 66,461 appointments that have not been scheduled in primary care at this facility. What happens when those appointments get scheduled? Wait time increases, correct? Wait time is calculated from the date the appointment is created until it's completed. How many days for the appointment to be made? This is not a one facility. Division 12 Medical Center, same thing for ophthalmology, 5-day established patient wait time. 2,100 clinical recalls that had not been scheduled yet. The patient was due to be seen, has not been seen yet. Solution, the CATS tool, all of supply, all of demand, and one sheet of paper for the entire medical center. You can, instead of looking at access silos, whack-a-mole for consults only, for the WL only. The purple column is what caused the access crisis right now. There's a lot more demand. The pink column is our supply, how many slots are in the grid that the patients can actually be seen. And then at a glance, you can see how many slots you're short or how many for that time frame by specialty, by cardiology, by dermatology. So you can see improvements over time, which is different to this dashboard. So benefits of CATS, it's transparent. All of access on
all right, paper. Time for questions and answers. And the buzzer rang. Okay. Panelists?
That was a quick preview.
It goes fast.
Quick question about your use of supply. What work did you do to do any validation in the grid availability and
things straight from this the grids of
so any work to validate what was actually in there.
Sorry.
The question was about grid validation.
Yes, it is validated through visiting the CDW. The grids were there. Wait time improvements, 60 days by specialty since implementation. And we have spread it to 116 medical centers since March of this year, thanks to the Innovators Network, so I wanted to make sure I get that. Copies, do you like to actually see your access results? We have 116 copies to spread throughout the facility. Other questions?
That's all the time we have. Thank you very much. Next up, Susan Hall.
My name is Susan Hall, and I'm a preventive medicine doctor at the VA Loma Linda Healthcare System called GeoCompass VA, which stands for Geospatial Community and Patient Assessment Strategy for veteran adherence. We all know poor adherence leads to more trips to the emergency department and hospitalizations. We found a very strong correlation between neighborhoods and adherence. Parent, it's likely you will be too. We also take patient traits from the VA CDW, things like psychiatric comorbidities, medical problems. We use logistic regression and patient-based traits to identify at-risk veterans. Looking for hot spots and cold spots. We also use a software called Tapestry Segmentation, a software that has clustered the entire United States into 67 neighborhood portraits. And every day, U.S. businesses use these portraits for targeted interventions for their customers. Now, I have some, the panelists have a list of a couple of these. I want you to notice on the back, neighborhood portraits I've given you have both have the same poor adherence. I also have these copies at my poster today. Used to proactively identify veterans at risk for poor adherence in order to design targeted interventions. A map of our area showing good and poor adherence. Red is poor. We also have a map here of the same area with health literacy, green being good and red being poor. And as you can see, if you look up near Inyo, it kind of corresponds to a little red area there. We have a green area, blue area of good adherence with a green health literacy. And even up top, we have a combination that is corresponding. Now, along the way, we have found some challenges and possible solutions. This is slow. And this is because of lack of time. This could be helped with additional technical support and dedicated local FTEs. I have no marketing experience. This would be solved by working with a firm that is familiar with market segmentation. For collaborators for veteran feedback. We have reached out recently to the Veterans Experience Office and Voices of Veterans.
Model validated in terms of, you know, are these factors predictive of poor outcomes, poor adherence to medication like from PBM? And secondly, have you considered comparing your model to other established VA models like the CAN score or some of the other models as well?
Well, the CAN score is part of our logistic regression, but unfortunately, due to everybody having other VA duties, 12 out of our 16 variables that we want to put into that logistic regression, but we're very close to doing that.
So you've got a great amount of data in it. Is this going to be driving patient education, or did, I guess, what's the driver?
That's certainly going to be one of the things based on the literacy map that we think will be important for our area, at least. I don't want to give providers, administrators this information. You know, with the human-centered design, co-design exactly the best way for them to use these. Two to three PAC teams at our facility, actively knowing, and then having something a little bit more targeted, everybody in a shotgun approach, because that's usually how we deal with poor adherence. We realize it later, and then we kind of, you know, just say the same thing to everybody.
Down here is Mark Mann, and he's presenting CTOS.
Hey, Mark Mann, Parkersburg VA Medical Center, Chief Mental Health Services. And when I heard about the Shark Tank, director Tim Cook was coming around asking us which ones he wanted, or which ones he did on. And when I seen this one, the CTOX, and an easy flow of getting to a bed to detox. And we were dealing with medical center, psychiatry, and medicine fighting with each other over where this veteran would be detoxed in our ED. Full problems for us. And lucky for us, as you've heard, VA Boston does a lot of great things. Well, they had figured this out for us and became our partners in this. And we used the center's design, so they took their algorithm, their templates, and brought them to the VA Martinsburg and helped us to do focus groups with all the different departments, ED, medicine, and psychiatry. Come up with our own evidence base and our agreed upon algorithm, which I'll show you at the end real quick. Team to come up with that algorithm. And then Dr. Karthik Shivasankar to help us train the staff at Martinsburg in using this. We instituted July 14th. So in the first month, we were able to 50% of the time, which was our goal, going across three different shifts, and we were able to take it from to an 18.5 minute, okay, 18 and a half minutes to deciding about needing a detox to actually accepting the veteran to the bed. And before it would take us 20 minutes just to find a doctor that would listen to the ED or who, where they would go. The feedback from our providers has been very positive. They would standardize, use evidence-based approaches, and improve our processes. Actually taking Martinsburg from a RFD to a modern detox system. Just bring it all back around. And world-class detox. I mean, we're using CWAS now, where Martinsburg was not using CWAS, which is an evidence-based approach, and doing our treatments. So this is the algorithm that we finally developed that the doctor uses. Thank you.
So when Boston came down with that algorithm, from your perspective, what was the biggest challenge your site had at following what was already done in Boston?
Well, I mean, mainly that it depended on who was in the ED, how they were deciding if the person needed which unit. So there was nobody using any standardized form. So we standardized all the tests up front and cutoffs that we would use for medicine, if it was evidence-based, if it wasn't agreed upon by medicine psychiatry.
This is very interesting and timely. You said it was also evidence-based. Can you talk a little bit more about how your e-consult improved care, quality care and outcomes?
Sure. You know, before you would get, we have a lot of psych unit. Some places have a separate detox unit, but our veterans would be in detox in a locked psych unit. From there, where they don't have the same medical care as the medical side, if there were things like CWAS over 15, which show a high rate of outcomes, we didn't even know because we weren't using the CWAS. And we were having veterans maybe start having seizures on the unit. Okay, so we have to transfer them back to medicine. Thank you.
Amber Lang presenting Consult Management Registry.
Hi, I'm Amber from the Portland, Oregon VA, and I'm here to talk about the consult management tool that we've created. So in Portland, we have one of the largest GI wait lists in the nation, and our consult numbers continue to grow and grow. So I sat with our scheduler to ask her how she manages this workload. And that piece of paper with the highlights is what she showed me. So basically, this is what she uses. Those highlighted areas are her attempt to try to meet the national mandates. Call, second call. And she's very frustrated because the system, she spends more time trying to figure out who to call than actually calling the veteran. It's creative, but it's inefficient and labor-intensive. And from the veteran's perspective, no matter what the symptoms are, if you're on page 8 or 9 of this list, it's going to take a while before you get a phone call. So we knew we could do better, so I called our innovation specialist, human-centered design, and we observed the schedulers. And with their input, we created a paper prototype. And we took that to our informatics department, and they created the tool for us to use, a working model, testing, and we piloted it with our GI department. And importantly, we had executive support throughout this entire process. This is what we have. So this is our web-based GI consult or consult tracker tool, GI department, and basically it tells the scheduler what task is due today. There's a workflow. They come in every morning and know what to do. Instead of using a highlighter, there's columns that say first, second, or third contact, what date they were done, if it was a call or a letter, so we can meet the national directives. That consult comes through. It shows up at the top in red so that they're not missed. And you can sort by a clinically indicated date, which is the urgency, rather than just the date the consult was ended. Let's see. And what we found out so far, we're still doing some impact evaluations, but the employees are happier. The number of outstanding consults has decreased. Improved efficiency and timeliness. That's improved access for veteran care. So back in Portland, we're planning on spreading this throughout our facility. And then in the near future, we have plans to share it with the rest of our VISN. And then because it leverages the consult toolbox, which is a national tool, we're hoping that others throughout the nation could benefit from this as well. But it was challenging and there were some hurdles when we were trying to figure this out, but we were open and took risks and we made it happen. We expect a lot of our frontline staff from them. So I hope that everyone else is willing to take this risk and help us share this tool across the nation. Thank you.
If you look at other tools across the VA, I'm shocked that others would still be using that paper highlighting process. I would think there's other tools out there.
Yeah, we couldn't find any.
More of a comment. I think there's a big opportunity for you if you set up the backbone of the database properly. I think you could capture some interesting analytics and best practices on engagement, and the cadence of that engagement. Mm-hmm. In fact, that if strong enough, I'm wondering if you could transpose that information on the geospatial solution on some of your higher risk patients.
Right.
So you could use that data intelligence to be better engaged.
Yeah, that's good. You got that, Judy? Okay.
Thank you. Just to that point, what ability does the tool currently have to write back to any of the current systems, or does it save and archive information by itself?
I'm going to let our innovation specialist answer that.
So right now, we're just calling extracting data from the corporate data warehouse. So we're leveraging the consult toolbox data, as Amber mentioned, and we are planning to embed our care management tool in there that does have a write-back capability, and we'll be using VIA, which is an improved web service, to be able to push information to a note as needed.
Thank you, guys.
We have gained a lot of information in a short time. So next we have Ann Melzer with a toolkit for the spread of lung cancer screening.
All right. So good morning. I'm Dr. Ann Melzer. Oh, wrong direction. I'm a pulmonologist at the Minneapolis VA, and I'm here to talk about our innovation, a toolkit for the spread of lung cancer screening. So lung cancer is the number one cancer killer in the United States and among our veterans. And this is mostly due to the fact that most cases aren't diagnosed until they've already spread. Lung cancer screening is a recent clinical innovation that uses low-dose CT scans to screen patients to find cancers earlier, and has been shown to reduce lung cancer-related mortality by about 20% in the patient population. So this approach was tested within the VA and shown to be both effective and feasible as part of a central office-sponsored demonstration project. However, several years after that project had wrapped up and data was available, both Portland and Minneapolis realized we're still the only sites in our business that are providing this service, and really only one of a handful nationally that are doing this. Ourselves, why aren't more VAs doing lung cancer screening, particularly given how high risk our veteran population is for lung cancer? We thought back to the many, many steps that we had undertaken at our sites and with the support of NCP, including database design, figuring out processes that work within the VA system, providing patient education materials, training staff, et cetera. Most of these are not things that need to be duplicated at each VA. They're really easy to package and export from site to site. And so that really led to the idea for our innovation, a toolkit for the spread of lung cancer screening, which is really conceptualized to be a practical, comprehensive way to sort of package and export an existing lung cancer screening program to a new site to save a lot of work and really streamline that process. So we actually, after we started down this road, were approached again as part of a larger diffusion effort by NCP, really trying to get sites to start adopting lung cancer screening. And so it's led to a great partnership where some of our tools that we've generated will be housed as part of their kind of national guidance website, and then the ones that really pertain to packaging up our program, our database, our templates, etc., will be on our own toolkits. So we've made a lot of progress. We've made our next batch of patient education handouts for focus testing with veterans. We process mapped about 10 different screening programs to find really methods that would work given different practice environments and different resources available. Discussions with about 15 interested sites across the nation. We presented to two hospital leaderships who are interested in adopting a similar program. One site has been committed to the database, and now our VISN leadership is interested in spreading similar programs throughout the VISN 23 sites. But of course, that kind of momentum of course needs ongoing support. So we need to really finalize as we test them on materials, and we'd really like to continue to provide in-person support as requested. Thanks.
Interesting. I understand from the research evidence that sometimes lung cancer screening can give folks a false sense of security if it's negative. Are you planning or do you have in mind ideas for linking that to smoking or tobacco cessation interventions given your connection to NCP?
Yeah, so it's great. So full disclosure, I'm a tobacco cessation researcher. So yes, and I think that's one of the things that really we struggle with, because a lot of people will say, well, I can do this, I can, and really, you know, it needs to be more than that, because it can't just be a doctor orders a scan. It has to be followed up, it has to be done in a protocolized way, and it has to involve smoking cessation treatment. And so how to get, especially rural sites, veterans access to smoking cessation treatment as part of this, we'll be looking into as an investigational topic, and then both Portland and us are doing some research projects trying to figure out the best ways to do that and how to target messaging and use things like maybe the Annie app to help link to this. So things that are already in existence that we can kind of roll into a comprehensive program, because I agree, look at the cost estimates. Screening is a reasonably cost-effective intervention on its own, but if you roll into tobacco cessation, it's far, far more beneficial clinically and from a cost-saving standpoint.
You have data that shows that how once you've introduced your toolkit to a new site, how that effect of that toolkit has been in increasing the cancer screen rates.
Yeah, so we're unfortunately a little early. I think none of the sites that we're working with have actually totally started yet. So that'll be one of the things that we'll track. Where the database is that they, it automatically generates that data.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm sorry.
Christina Aguilar, and she's presenting patient-centered flow design and analysis for dialysis. Forgive me.
Good morning. My name is Christina Aguilar again. My innovation uses a nursing informatics approach to address the patient and workflow issues in the dialysis setting. As a veteran who receives care at the VA, I wanted to create something that would help reduce the delays and excessive waiting times, as well as make the job for the nurses a little bit more easier. So this was my slide here. We're going to go here. So challenges that we faced were all of our second shift patients had the same appointment times at 11 a.m. on a clipboard and were caught on a first-come, first-served basis. This led patients competing to get to the dialysis unit first, sometimes hours before their appointment time. Waiting rooms, and the average waiting time of 20 minutes to an hour and a half. While the patients waited, the team leader had to handwrite the assignment and try to figure out where to assign each patient and nurse's chairs opened up. Because patients don't have assigned chairs on second shift, there's many delays in patient flow. Machines can't be set up in advance to put patients' names in the prescription bags. Chairs and stretchers have to be moved around constantly. Wait for the team leader to figure out the assignment before preparing their supplies. So to address these issues, we placed a kiosk in the waiting area to keep the patients out of the unit during turnover. The use of staggered appointment times and permanent chair assignments were then explored. We did this by collecting data on each chair for about 3 weeks to determine when the average time each of these chairs opened up. So for example, during chair one, the data showed that it was ready around 11:15. So we would place a second shift patient with the right access because the machine's on the right and who wants a stretcher in this spot. We'd be introducing an electronic system to all the staff and training them and getting them off the paper and pencil method. That way they can focus on dashboard in the waiting area where patients can actually see whether their chair is ready or not. The next slide hopefully is a video that has sound and you can hear it. I'm not sure if it works or not, but you can pretty much just, this is the program right
here. Workflow process by saving time on repetitive tasks, reducing errors, and improving on communication. Provides the ability to link to a dashboard in the waiting room. Chair each morning as they become available, a substantial amount of time and steps have been reduced for the team leader. Patients are expected to arrive at their newly scheduled appointment time and be dialyzed in the same chair each treatment unless otherwise instructed. They will be permitted in the unit once their chair status says ready on the dashboard.
It worked.
Anybody? Okay, I was just wondering if you captured any patient satisfaction scores.
At the beginning, we wanted to collect, you know, what they thought about it. Now we already know that they don't like it because they're waiting so long, and they voice that concern to us every day. So basically, after we implement this, I have to train all the staff on this Excel-based spreadsheet application that I created. And then we'll start getting the data from there.
Yeah, and for dialysis staff, about how many minutes savings are you seeing?
Well, just for the team leader to make the assignment, it's usually 20 to 30 minutes, depending on the team leader. Sometimes it can take longer than that. We have chairs open, but since the team leader hasn't made the assignment yet, patients are still having to wait. So we want to reduce that time.
So the dashboard is static. Did you say it's in Excel with a static?
Yeah, so basically the team leader
has... It doesn't tie into the check-in.
At the kiosk, but it's a computer-based program, so we have two monitors. The second monitor would display the information with no patient identification, and it mirrors a dashboard in the waiting area. So as soon as the team leader updates it that this chair is ready, they'll see it right away from there. My vision was actually creating, this is just a proof of concept, of course. I would like this, you know, I envision it to be a more computer application that actually takes patient data out of the VA. There's lots of ideas that you could use this, such as text messaging using mobile technology. So.
And last but not least, we have Keith Burrell presenting adaptive polysomnography.
Morning, everyone. My name is Keith Burrell. I'm from the San Antonio VA, and I work on the spinal cord injury unit, and I'm here to talk about adaptive polysomnography. So the prevalence of obstructive sleep apnea in the general population is estimated to be about 8%. In the spinal cord injury population, some studies show it being as high as 80%. So for reasons not fully understood, spinal cord injury in and of itself seems to be a risk factor for the development of obstructive sleep apnea. These are some of the long-term health consequences of untreated obstructive sleep apnea. Obviously, most of them are life-changing and some are life-threatening, so untreated obstructive sleep apnea is not a good idea. Polysomnography is the gold standard test to diagnose obstructive sleep apnea. The colloquial term for it is a sleep study. More and more, especially in the private sector, the way sleep studies are performed, it is a sleep lab or contract with a hotel. A patient checks into the hotel for the evening, sleeps in the bed overnight, hooked up to a bunch of sleep equipment, monitor overnight, and by morning a diagnosis is made by a doctor. Not really an option for our spinal cord patients, especially the high tetraplegics, because they have many care needs that can't be met without nursing care or a host provider. That includes bowel and bladder care, specialty mattresses, specialty transfer equipment, nursing care or provider care overnight, turning every 2 hours. So currently there is really no option for a high tetraplegic patient to get a full-on polysomnographic test. We do have a sleep clinic up on the 7th floor of a local hospital shown on the bottom right, but they don't have any nursing staff, and they especially don't have any specialty nursing staff, so our patients don't have access. A picture of our unit. On the far right, you'll see a little bitty nurse. They're down by the nursing station. On the left, I put a star by a special room we call the independent living apartment, shown on the bottom right here. That room is only used about once a month, and we use it to transition the acute rehab patients back to the home setting. It just helps get them ready for it. Our idea was to put mobile polysomnographic equipment into that room on a cart, modify the call switch so that a paddle style switch could be used so that a high tetraplegic patient keeps their face to call, put a data drop in so that that equipment can be sent, the data can be sent up to the 7th floor. The patient has a sleep study performed on our floor with our specialty nurses right there. They can be called if needed. My morning diagnosis can be made. It kind of combines the two, and if anything goes wrong, the sleep tech can call our nurses, and our nurses can come if needed. Progress to date is we've already changed the call buttons, so it will take the paddle style switch. We are currently pending purchasing of the actual equipment, which is just kind of a lesson learned. Buy early once you have the funding. We've been working with contracting on a local level, trying to get that handled. So progress to come. We're pending equipment. Seeing many questions.
Have you thought of moving this to the home for recent studies?
I think it'd be a great idea. I think it'd be a little more difficult because a lot of the home studies in theory would be performed usually with a care provider, someone that's not necessarily trained in how to set up polysomnography. So the thought here is that there's a video attached to this cart so they can literally watch the patient, watch the nurse on the phone doing it, say, no, no, it's the left, to the right. So it's a tech and a nurse combined team, whereas at home, it'd probably be a care provider, possibly spouse. You don't know what the training level is or comfortable with adjusting equipment, but I think it'd be a great idea. Something called a watch pad, but it doesn't differentiate obstructive from central sleep apnea, so it's not really an option. So you have to be full on trying.
So that was our last presentation, and I want to thank everyone for, I especially appreciate the knowing laughs when he was talking about some of the challenges he had. We're going to have a slide come up in just a minute that explains how we're going to do the poll everywhere portion of things, and so for this, essentially what happens is we're going to have some a graph that's live, so we'll ask for you, we'll put up the names of all of the presenters and their presentations. For you, as hard as it is, to pick just one and text in the number for that one once we've given you the instructions to do that, and that will indicate a vote for that particular project. And if all goes well, we've used this successfully before, so I'm hopeful. The program will show us the live results as they're tallied. We have our technical folks working on this. I feel like I should know a little bit. so I wanted to answer something. Andrea's usually up here doing that. One thing I'll mention too while we have a moment is that at the conclusion of the poll, then to help make up some time, we're just going to have a 5-minute break to transition between Rio to a discussion that's in another room other than this one. We're just going to keep it at 5 minutes instead of 10. And so we'd like to ask if they're already here, if any of the people who are presenting for the next round in this room could start to make your way down here to the front to our special reserve seating area, and it will help us stay on track. All right, here we go. So here's what you do. Can you move it over to the left a little bit, I think?
In the meantime, if you want to go to that hyperlink at the top, pollev.com/Andrea IPPOLI917. And then what you're going to see is you see the 10 presentations that just went through. Ooh, we'll have that come up in just the GIF. And you're going to see a 6-digit code that you're going to text in. All right, so we're bringing that up. Right, you guys are our beta testers for Poll Everywhere. So here we go. There's the link. And then some votes are already starting to come in. You can see that 6-digit code. 6-digit code. 22333. Sorry, we're moving it to the left. Go to that link and text to 22333, the 6-digit code you see there. Keep those votes coming in. Woo-hoo! I wish I had a tambourine. All right, we can't see it. It's a horse race between automation and cancer surveillance and survivorship, clinical access tool, data-driven OR scheduling, and patient-centered flow design. And all of them have 3 codes. We're going to slide it over. We're going to keep you in suspense. 10 more seconds. 10 more seconds. 22333. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and the winner is 5 more seconds. still coming. Well, let's call it as a tie. Get the final answer, but it's a tie right now between data-driven OR scheduling and patient-centered flow design. Woo! All right, so those 2 folks will go into the final set of Poll Everywhere reviews. We'll let you know if the winner culminates. So they'll go into the final Poll Everywhere polling at the end of the day. All right, so we're gonna get started with our next set of panelists. So panelists and presenters, come down. Thank you so much to our fabulous panel.
Very nice to see you.
If you are a presenter for panel 3, please come down here and look for me. I'm in the bright blue. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I know my
gonna make a run for it. Thank you.
Okay, folks, we'll be starting in about a minute or so, so you may want to get situated. Folks, we're going to get started. I'm Wayne Martin, and I'm going to split MC with Glenn Weichel here. I'm going to take the first five presenters, and he's going to take the last five. All right, to get started, I'm going to name our panelists and the positions. We have Ariane Miller, Managing Director of the Lab at Office of Personnel Management, Charles Worthington, Chief Technology Officer, Department of Veteran Affairs, Acting Director of Office of Innovation and Entrepreneurship, U.S. Department of Commerce, Joseph Ronzio, Deputy Chief Health Technology Officer, Department of Veteran Affairs, Marianne Schlossenizzi, Shaughnessy, thank you, Director of Facility-Based Programs Office of Geriatrics and Extended Care, VHA, Patrick Littlefield, Executive Director of VA Center for Innovation, Penny Nechaniki, National Director of Prosthetics and Sensory Aids, Department of Veteran Affairs, Rick Starr, CEO of National Association of Veterans Research and Education Foundations, and Sherman Gillums, Executive Director of Paralyzed Veterans of America. All right, you guys ready? Go. First, we're going to have April Ma, Technology-Based Eye Care Services, Beyond Screening.
All right, good morning, everyone. It's an honor to be here, so thank you for having me. Before I tell you a little bit more about what Atlanta's been doing with the text program, I want to remind you about one of my patients, Mr. C. Gentleman who lives in Blairsville, which is 2 hours from the main eye clinic, and he sees me 3 years ago, desperate for some glasses to help his failing eyesight. Sorry, this thing is not on. It's not advancing. I'm sorry. My time. there we go. All right. So he's here for glasses because he has some failing eyesight, but actually I ended up diagnosing him with advanced open-angle glaucoma, and he's now legally blind from this disease. And if I had been able to find him sooner, I would have been able to do more for him than I could now. And it's patients like this, along with our rapid growth rate in Atlanta and our large geographic catchment area, that led us to develop the technology-based eye care services program in 2015. We station an ophthalmology technician to provide screening and eyeglasses to our veterans closer to their home at their primary medical care clinic. Successful that through the help of Office of Rural Health and VACI, we're able to spread the program to 4 VAs across the country this fiscal year, and we hope that 5 more will join us in 2018. Thinking, what more could we do with techs? So if you take techs and you add some extra equipment, what do you get? You get innovation number 1, which is teleglaucoma. So before, when you have a disease, you couldn't go back to techs. You had to drive all the way to the main eye clinic for care. But now, by adding some equipment, we can provide patients that state of the art and give them the testing they need at their primary care clinic, with the hope that if we make it easier for them to get care, they'll have better adherence. So what happens if you add text with an industry giant, Google? What do you get? Well, you get innovation number 2, which is computer-assisted automated image interpretation. So one day we hope we'll be able to take our images, put it together to a computer, and find out which patients truly need our attention first. So we've been really busy this year. We've been able to provide care through our teleglaucoma pathway to a few patients, and we're developing a way to transfer images to Google. We ask that the VA continue to support innovative strategies as break down barriers. So I'm proud to tell you today that text is going beyond screening in our ever-present fight to prevent blindness.
Two minutes.
Well, I'm glad you asked that. The text screening program refers about 30% of our veterans for various eye diseases. 25% are either for frank glaucoma or suspicion for glaucoma. And so text is available for any veteran in the system and every veteran. Since 2015, we've screened about over 6,000 veterans through the text program in Atlanta alone.
I say that what you've done is virtualized a kind of a care modality that was only available at the medical center and pushed out to the C-box.
Yes, I think that that's a perfect example. And it's building upon innovation such as diabetic teleretinal screening that's been very successful.
Tell me about the interaction with Google. How easy is that to forge? What were the steps you had to get?
It's been a 2-year process. I'm still working on it. That's how easy it is. But we will persevere because that's how we get things done. Yes.
Believe it or not,
it exists. It mainly exists for diabetic teleretinal screening, but other engineering companies have done it for macular degeneration, cataract, and things like that. And so I think it's just reading data and putting all of the algorithms together, because a human reader is not going to ignore a cancer in the eye just because it's a diabetic teleretinal screening. So that's why it's being more sophisticated to help us. My time is up. Thank you guys.
So next up, insulin infusion calculator, Andrew Kelly, VA Boston.
Hello, everybody. My name is Andrew Kelly.
Hello.
Hi. My name is Andrew Kelly. I'm a registered nurse at the VA in Boston. Intensive care unit. I made a tool, but before I get to it, I just want to give a quick background. In the 80s, they found that uncontrolled blood sugars can lead to poor patient outcomes, hyperglycemia, and they found that after having an operation, if you controlled the patient's blood sugar aggressively, they would have better outcomes, lower mortality, lower morbidity, etc. In Boston, particularly, we use a 2012 guideline version of what they developed in Portland. And, you know, the nurse will, depending on what the blood sugar falls into, and right there in the middle. First, an example. So if you're in between 90 and 150 on your blood sugar, you know, if you have a decrease, say, from 156 to 140, you go down to that calculation. And if you're less than 10% lower, you decrease by 0.5. If you're more than 10% lower, you decrease by 50%. But this is a human doing that calculation. If you drop from, say, 280 to 140, going in at 10 units per hour, down 5, because you want to be aggressively getting off the insulin because you had such a drastic drop. But if you do the math wrong and you only decrease it to 9.5, you're going to bottom out the patient's blood sugar. So this is a protocol that's not without risk. So my idea was to take the human out of the math. So I noticed that the protocol, it sounded a lot like, you know, logic in Excel. I'm using a little equations. I made a calculator. So you input the current and the previous blood sugars, and it just spits out what to do. And for patient safety reasons, is my goal would be to decrease hypoglycemic events. In implementation, you know, I spoke with pharmacy, endocrinology, clinical practice committee, as much as I could. And what I'm doing right now is monitoring glycemic quality. So in the 7 previous months before my between 1 and 6 hypoglycemic events per month, averaging around 3 month after my tool was implemented, and it was 0. That continues, and that's not just an anomaly. But I'll have more data as time goes on. And if other people want to use it, you know, my program is only as good as the protocol it's based on, so they'd have to be using the same protocol. But in the future, that protocol we use is already a simplified version. So if you have it done automatically, advance and address the protocol.
Nice job. 2 minutes of Q&A.
Thank you. This is a great idea. Is this in CPRS?
No, the way I have it now, it's just an Excel file that you can only modify those two green blocks that I showed. Everything else is protected, so you can't change the program, God forbid. And in the ICU, every patient, there's a bedside computer for, you know, scanning medications. This is another thing on that computer that you can pull up. Another goal I had would maybe be create an app in the pocket, because they might not be at the bedside when they're doing this, but this is all up in the air currently.
To put this into my medical center, how much employee time will it take to transfer it in, and then what's the sustainability time frame?
My part's easy. The hard part would be accepting this would create, you know, a difference in policy. So every facility is, from what I understand, the endocrine service decides that protocol. There's no national standard. If there was a national standard, we could have a very complicated machine that instead of, like, say, 90 to 150, you could have to the exact blood sugar make a change. You could have a very aggressive and a very safe.
I have a question around the sharing process. What did you learn anything you were able to share back to Portland since you benefited from their work in the first place?
I have not.
Yes.
How have your colleagues in nursing responded to this?
Mostly positive. People like it. It takes less time. Sometimes they're scratching your head, like less than 10% more than, or more than 10% less than, you know. So a lot of people appreciate it. Some people say, I've been doing it for 20 years. I'm not going to change now. Then, want it, great, but I'm not forcing it down anyone's throat currently. Thanks, Andy.
Next up, continuous measuring of blood pressure in the home environment, Frank Giacono and Benjamin Vandendreiske from the Lewis Stokes Cleveland VA.
Thank you very much. My name is Frank Giacono. This is Ben Vandendreiske. We're happy to be here from the Cleveland VA to talk to you about our SPARK project, making continuous measurements of blood pressure in the home environment. As everyone knows, high blood pressure is a major problem. For both within the VA as well as for all Americans. One in three Americans have high blood pressure, but only 54% of them have that hypertension well controlled. Both primary and secondary hypertension are a big problem, huge healthcare expenditures. The clinical standard is a blood pressure cuff measured in the hospital. The VA is already actually a leader in home telehealth, where we bring the blood pressure device into the home and make a measurement. But even that is a single measurement a day. It's when the patient is sort of sitting in a chair. It doesn't capture daily activities, fluctuations in blood pressure around stress, or medication dosing. What we are advocating is the use of low-profile wearable devices, which could make continuous measurements of blood pressure. What we're using now is a single device on the wrist or finger, which measures the PPG, or blood pulse flow, and a second device worn on the chest, which measures ECG, or the electrical activation of the heart. When we have all of that data together, we can make estimates of blood pressure. The current protocol here, which you can see a research subject, is wearing both the wearable devices and has measurements of blood pressure made with the gold standard. We're using a head-up tilt maneuver to cause changes in blood pressure and heart rate so that we can then calibrate our measurements with the gold standard devices. Ben is going to talk to you about some of the data we're collecting.
So as Dr. Chabon already introduced, this is the data that we're getting out of the wearable system. So in blue you have the ECG signal, in orange the PPG, or the blood pulse flow signal. And then we can derive a couple of parameters from that, including the heart rate, the pulse transit time, which is the time delay between the contraction of the heart and the actual arrival of the blood pulse flow in the periphery, as well as the PPG amplitude. We collected data on a number of patients. This is one of them, well, not patients, subjects. So on the left, you see the systolic blood pressure and the heart rate. And it's HUT, that's head up tilt, so that's when we tilt the table up. And you can see that both of those go up because of the tilting the table. And on the right side, you see the pulse transit time going down after the head up tilt, which coincides with the increase in blood pressure, where you get a stiffening of the vessel wall and thus a decrease in the travel time. And below that is the PPG amplitude, which also drops because of the head up tilt. So we're still adding a couple of subjects to the study to increase our data set, with the ultimate goal of finding parameters that correlate well with BP. In the longer term, our goal is to move from the current prototype device that we're using now to lifewise wearable devices. I've got one in my hand here, so you can see the size, so that we can move to monitoring of veterans in the home environment to collect these parameters.
Thank you.
Nice job. 2 minutes, question and answer.
Have you talked to veterans? Does anyone actually want to wear this?
So when we were developing the project, we asked patients, but it was a very generic question. We were open to it, but not surprisingly, we didn't have to wear it. We also talked to providers, wondering if continuous blood pressure measurements would be helpful to them in making treatment decisions. I think the veterans who might be most open to this are people with really difficult to control high blood pressure, and it's not exactly sure what's happening, or they're having symptoms related to their medications as you try to titrate those in. And so we wouldn't envision that everyone needs to be wearing these all the time, but when you're trying to optimize a difficult to control patient, we would envision that having this continuous blood pressure data could really be helpful in making those medication titration decisions.
Do you have the data systems available to integrate with the health program or any other programs for data consolidation?
we don't hear, although we're in a completely unrelated project, we're using the home telehealth system to collect data from COPD patients in collaboration with some home-based environmental air quality monitors. So we have some experience with that, although we have not taken that step with this project.
I think your hypothesis is that continuous monitoring would allow you to better manage hypertension, resulting in reduced hypertension. Assuming people wear the device, what's the hardest part of this? Not the data, applying it clinically to get a result you're after.
From our perspective, it is collecting enough data from the wearable devices to build a large enough data set so we can do the analysis required to make the estimation equations and the measurements. Once we have that in hand, then it's going to be basically pushing that out to veterans, finding people who would be willing to be part of a clinical trial so that they can wear it day to day. Yes, thank you.
Thank you. So, Frank and Ben aren't going to go anywhere. You may think they're going to have a second innovation, but we call them super innovators. All right?
So it's Frank and Ben again.
So it's fall prevention using real-time dynamic body position monitoring.
Thank you. So now that you know the title, we'll jump right into it. A big problem, particularly in elderly patients. One in five falls actually results in a serious injury. Death rates from unintentional falls are rising year by year, partly because of our aging population. Falls lead to 800,000 hospitalizations per year and are a leading cause of healthcare dollars spent and traumatic brain injury. So what we would envision is if we can have dynamic measures of body position that we could then identify patients at risk for falls. The industry standard at left is basically a number of external cameras which capture motion. We're fortunate at the Cleveland VA as part of the APT, Advanced Platforms Technology Center, within the hospital facility to have one of these gold standard systems. What we've been doing now is using a different set of wearables from the ones we just talked to you about. In these, the subject is wearing 8 wearable devices on the arms and legs. Those devices are inertial monitoring units, which make measurements of acceleration, as well as use a gyroscope to detect changes and turns. These devices are, again, low profile and ultimately could be integrated into commonly worn jewelry or garments. And what we've been doing is, so you can see Ben walking up there on the right. The data on the left is from the gold standard motion tracking system that we have in place. And Ben's also wearing the prototype wearables so that we can then compare data from the wearables with the gold standard. Here's some of the data that is collected. Ben's going to talk to you about that.
That we get from the wearable devices. So you have the acceleration for all 8 sensors, depending on the position where it was placed, and then an XYZ, which is the acceleration in the X, Y, or Z direction. So in this particular excerpt, you see me take 6 steps and then turn, which if, for instance, you focus on the top left graph, which is the one that was positioned on the left upper arm, you can see that cyclical behavior in the signal as well. We did 2 things with the data. One, we compared it to the motion tracking data. So the motion tracking data, we transported into acceleration data, and then we overlaid it with the actual acceleration data in orange on the graph. You can see that they match up pretty well. The thing we did was build a small classifier. This was done by Internet Whitefly Spheres. So we grabbed some of the walking and running data, we used it to build a classifier, and then we grabbed a new data set. We did some more of that activity, but interspersed it with more, different activities. And then the classifier was supposed to detect, we did a pretty good job detecting walking and running, more things that were out of sample. So the as for the other project, we're increasing the number of subjects in the study to improve on the correlation with the motion tracking data and the classification.
Yeah, how different is the technology in the wearables you were testing compared to the accelerometer that I find on my phone or a Fitbit or something similar?
It is very similar. The main difference is that because it's built into this wearable, you can position it exactly where you need it.
you also get more control of the phone. You know, it's loose in your pocket. That's very different from a system where you have a body, you can extrapolate from there.
And we're starting with 8 sensors, but we ultimately will like to pare that down to the smallest number of sensors needed to get the required information to identify patients whose gait is transitioning to a basement at-risk state.
So have you already done the evaluation of several of the health research apps that are already out there doing this with Apple or Google phones in your office? What was their deficiency versus what, I mean, what's the use case that they're going to catch if they're not already catching them?
So I'm not aware of any of them that are already actively used to detect falls. I know they're working on it. The main application I've seen so far is looking at tremors. So this is moving away from that to really look at, can we actually get to get a more accurate measure of a more accurate metric to use for deterioration of patients with risk for falls.
About the clinical application of this, what do you expect the nurses, the caretakers to do with it?
Right, so I mean, there's several different things. One application that was born out of it is actually a functional electrical stimulation where you actually use nerve stimulation to assist the patient who might fall. This could be sort of just a fall alarm, a learning from a nursing home or a hospital care unit. It could be used in physical therapy sessions. And ultimately, I think we would, this patient has a 10% risk of fall, this patient has a 70% risk of fall. And if we can see information about how the coordination between their limbs is changing over time, getting better or worse, we might be able to take additional
So next presenter, Mary Henzel from the Lewis Stokes Cleveland VA Smart Foot Position Sensor to prevent power wheelchair user foot and leg injuries.
Dr. Christy Henzel, here with some of our team from the Cleveland VA Spinal Cord Injury and Advanced Platform Technology Center. A smart foot position sensor for prevention of power wheelchair user foot and leg injuries. Power chairs are a game changer for veterans with spinal cord injury and other neuromuscular diseases and repositioning. To do this, power chairs must be both compact and agile enough for use in the real world. Today, most rehab power chairs achieve this mid-wheel drive, which requires narrow center mount foot plates. For our veteran population, this can be dangerous because of many conditions it can displace the feet from the foot plates. Even in a optimally configured chair, bounce off the foot plates. We have seen this. This is a particular concern for veterans with SCI who can neither feel nor see their feet. This causes devastating injuries, including this veteran, who was unaware that he was dragging his foot and abrading through his shoe. Range from pressure ulcers to fractures to amputations as seen here. We've also identified media reports suggesting that at least one veteran with SCI has died due to this type of injury. So the big question is, how much is this costing veterans in the VA system? Veterans and their families is immeasurable, with too many experiencing decreased quality of life and lost opportunities while hospitalized for treatment. These economic costs are unknown for this underrecognized problem, but informal survey of other VA SCI centers and non-VA SCI providers revealed that while these injuries, they are not isolated events. Our medical center alone has spent tens of thousands of dollars on patient bed days of care, surgeries, and wound management. The innovative solution to this problem is to develop a smart sensing system. Type combines force and proximity sensors with a wireless feedback device. The footplate sensors connect to a software interface which is currently a smartphone app with adjustable alarm preferences. Watch our current danger alert algorithm. Here we have good, bad, bad. This next prototype is designed to fit
the power which took place in our system, used in our system, and there's our video. Keep going.
Any questions?
Have you been in contact with the manufacturers of these chairs to see if we could help them test similar features to put in all of them?
So the manufacturers think that this is user error. They seem to not recognize the fact that people with spinal cord injury that use their devices have impaired sensation. The majority of people using their chairs are able to tell where their feet are. Our patient population is not. The mod database for the FDA. Every single one of these events, they say it's a user error. They are not being particularly responsive to our suggestions that part of the problem. But we think it's an incredibly important problem.
Or have you actually built this and tested it?
So what we were going to do was we were going to invite you to our demonstration this evening for a live demo and up close look at our system. So it is a real live prototype. It has not been tested in veterans because of the IRB regulations, which take time to get through, because we do want to be able to publish this information.
Have you engaged with Paralyzed Veterans of America, PVA? They could be a strong external voice, for example, with manufacturers.
We concur. We think we need a little more data, time to be able to engage that. But we're currently considering them as, you know, funding sources for additional work on these projects.
In terms of quantifying, could you take a sample of patients identified as having derived the injury from this issue and at least total that up into what we think the cost is? I don't think I saw that in here.
So we don't know exactly how many. There are really problems between linking the mechanism of injury with the actual injuries. So I can tell you how many I've had, but I can't tell you societally.
All right, Lynn's going to take it from here. All right, so next we have serious games for difficult airway management by the French VA Acute Staff.
Hi, I'm Eric French, I'm an emergency physician in the emergency department in Seattle, Washington. I have a master's degree in healthcare simulation and certified healthcare simulation expert, educator, which gave me an interest in serious games and simulation. Our project involves using the serious game and blended learning for high stakes, low frequency airway emergencies. I spent a good part of my 35-year military career in aviation and surface operations, where serious games and simulation play an important part for training for frequency events, particularly in aviation. Our goal is to use simulation and serious game to teach standardized approach to difficult airways and also teach an open surgical cricothyrotomy technique.
3% of all routine airways are unanticipated.
I don't know why that happened. But 1-3% of airways become difficult airways. I didn't put that in.
This is a picture of an actual surgical cricothyrotomy. Our Innovation Seed project is to validate and screenshot of the actual dark series game, showing the learner manipulating the instruments for surgical cricothyrotomy.
Okay, that was a picture of the vortex cabinet made with an intuitive. This is 3D printing of an airway as part of this project too. Who's here also did help us do this with CT scanning an airway so that we can reproduce it more anatomically accurately. CT scanner.
The benefits for VA patients and clinical providers: patient safety by reducing morbidity or mortality, training costs.
This project is scalable. We hope to implement this into a spread project with mobile education teams, distributed simulation or VA network using internet technologies, develop cognitive aids similar to checklists the pilots use for difficult airway approach, to implement virtual and augmented reality into the serious game and the simulation, use those technologies. I think this is part of the Secretary's priority of modernization to try to bring us into the technologies of using serious games and simulation. Any questions?
Are you looking at any corporate partners or even other federal partners? I know the DoD is heavily invested in medical simulation.
Not formally gone to them yet. We are following what they're doing. We are presenting this at the joint VA-DoD anesthesia conference in Boston in December, working with the Society of Airway Management. But as far as the simulation, we haven't formally partnered with DoD or folks up at Fort Detrick, which is where I live for.
Can you tell me who's eligible to take this training? Who's the target audience for this?
The target audience is anyone who manages an airway, particularly intubation. So that would be all emergency physicians, which is more emergency physicians are all DoD combined of all the services, anesthesiologists, and intensivists. Probably about 4,000 practitioners is the target audience for this.
I'm not familiar with the term serious game. What does that mean in this context?
Was issued a slide rule when I went to college. But the serious game is gamification of educational programs, interaction with the learner where they advance in different levels.
Yeah, a comment I was going to offer is that the design of the game itself is its own area of expertise beyond the medical side of it. So I'd encourage thinking about resources to support that actual simulation. Right?
We did that with the company contracted it to similar down in Orlando.
Okay, and next we have 3D printing foot orthosis outcome testing. Jeffrey Heckman, VA Puget Sound.
Thank you. My name is Dr. Heckman. I'm the medical director of the Regional Amputation Center in Seattle, Washington. And this is our project from our Seed Innovation Grant. So at VA, we have a problem. We have 563,000 veterans who are literally steps away from amputation. Diabetes, neuropathy, using inappropriate footwear will develop foot ulcers. What's going to happen next? Will they heal and continue to be at high risk? Will they develop that foot ulcer, lead to infection and amputation? So current VA standard is that prescribed custom foot orthoses and specialty diabetic shoes are prescribed for all of these veterans. A process that at our facility requires multiple visits and takes about 3 weeks for delivery, a process that we feel needs to be significantly improved and can be improved to improve the timeliness using advanced technology. Our project, the 3DP foot project, is designing and developing a semi-automated process whereby we can revolutionize custom foot orthotics. It initiates with a clinician's evaluation and a scan of the veteran's foot. And with that digital scan, we're able to capture custom features and render them to a computer to create a virtual model of the veteran's foot. Provide with custom software and sent to a 3D printer. And once printed, the custom foot orthotic can be fit and delivered with same or next day service. The timeliness is our approach here to decrease wait times and in turn prevent infection and amputation. But I think with similar importance, as the Secretary mentioned this morning, keeping our employees engaged in this process. And if you can imagine, this is a potentially monotonous process of developing these. This is going to give them more of an enhanced design control over the process and really show our value in their scope of practice and skill. And then all of these benefits come together with increased durability to really improve the veterans' access and experience. So a brief progress report. We've already partnered with academic University of Washington, community partners with Fathom locally, and industry partners. Really where we want to go is to that we received from the SEED project and build on that and grow with increased funding to continue to optimize strategies for 3D printing foot orthotics for this at-risk veteran population.
This is exciting for a lot of reasons. Being prosthetics, footwear is a lot of what we do, so thank you for what you're doing here. Have you done any clinical efficacy in terms of comparison to the more traditional foot orthotics and how well the patients are doing with that?
So what we've been able to do with this project is bring the team together and then develop prototypes. And we still need to continue to iterate on that process and improve on our approach. At VA Puget Sound in Seattle, we have been developing PDR-X, which is an in-shoe plantar pressure measurement tool. So we have our current standard, the custom foot orthosis that we order every day, 2,000, 6,000 a year. And so we'll be able to prepare our future prototypes as we continue to advance and iterate on our approach.
So can you talk a little bit more about the timeliness on it?
So currently, as I mentioned, it takes about 3 weeks for that delivery of the custom foot orthotics. So the process is our clinician receives a consult, sees the patient, develops a crush box that requires purchasing and contracting and to go outside to a central fabrication process. About 3 weeks later, we need to bring the patient back in for another appointment that they need to show up for, and then we need to fit and deliver the orthotic. So the idea here is by keeping the veteran engaged early on in the process, using advanced technology, being able to get this 3D printed more efficiently with an in-house 3D printer, we may be able to provide that same-day service.
Can you talk about what training is required to operate these machines?
The handheld 3D scanner that we purchased from Artec, the Space Spider, comes with training and software. So we're able to work directly with the manufacturer on training our clinical orthotists. But these are skilled experts in kind of developing custom orthotics and custom prosthetics. Most of our orthotists are also certified prosthetists. So these are skilled people working with their hands who are able to utilize this technology.
Printing, 3D printing for pre-surgical planning, Beth Ripley, VA Puget Sound.
Hi guys, my name is Beth Ripley. I'm here from VA Puget Sound in Seattle, and my project is looking at 3D printing for pre-surgical planning. So medical imaging is increasingly complex and difficult to understand. So radiologists like me spend at least 5 years training and usually more to be able to understand these difficult and complex images, to put that into words and send out a written report. And you can imagine that no matter how good you are, trying to basically reduce very complex anatomy down into simply words is very challenging. So you could say, well, why doesn't the doctor or the patient just look at the images themselves? And of course they can, but sometimes it can be hard. For example, here are some images here. Does anyone know what this is? Show of hands. I'll give you more pictures, another angle, anyone? Pictures, anyone? Does anyone know what this is? Anyone? Show of hands. Okay, so that's the point, is that we are hardwired as humans in our brains to understand 3D objects. And I think we all can agree, we might argue if it's an alligator or a crocodile,